Last night, I watched the San Francisco Giants clinch the National League West Division Championship with 10 games left to go on their schedule. So they did it way ahead of time. How they do it? By keeping the pedal to the metal. Trying to win every game. And that's a great inspiration to remind us that we need to clinch ahead of time also. What does clinching ahead of time mean? It means, once again, to allow the fragrance of remembrance to permeate us, which is beyond belief, that which belief will never believe in. To let that happen now. Don't wait for belief to believe in it, because it never will. What will happen is we'll get swept up in events, and we don't want to get swept up in events. We want to clinch early. That is my goal. Don't wait till things really start boiling in this world. We've seen the lid of the pot is jostling around. You know, the steam is starting to build. You know, but at some point, poof, the lid comes off, right? It builds up too much steam. And we have been seeing how all these various situations that are arising are building up a lot of steam. We must not wait for events to unfold. We must clinch early. And today is a fantastic day, a great day. Thunderous clarifications. Stunning clarifications. Which are leading toward an early clinching of the situation. Not a minute too soon, not a minute too soon at all. We must not put the times to the test. We must already be established in that seamless flow of the fragrance of remembrance, the I am presence of isness, unconditional love. We must already be established in that. Allow that to be seamless. We're not looking for an experience, a one-off experience. We're looking for an experiencing. We don't want to say, yeah, I had this experience back in September of 2012. As everything in the world is boiling over, we say, oh, I remember I had an experience back in September 2012. No. We want to say, my experiencing began in September 2012, and it continues to this day. That's what we want to be able to say. My experiencing began at that time. That's the goal. We want to be in the playoffs. We want to clinch our position. We want to be assured of moving past all this. We want assured that we're not, cannot be touched by the terrors of the world. So we're not looking for an experience. No, an experiencing, ongoing. So the invitation we're giving out is an ongoing. And of course, belief will never believe it. We'll never reach a point where belief will believe that there's anything beyond belief. Never. But that doesn't mean that we cannot be experiencing that which is beyond belief. We certainly can. It's just that belief won't believe it, which is okay. It never will believe it. Not a problem. We don't have to get belief to believe it. Because it never will. But belief is something we can set down because it's just an effect of an idea. We can choose a new idea. It's not a permanent fixture at all. Dreams are not permanent. They may claim a lot of time, endless time for themselves, but they're not permanent. Because we'll get tired of the dream and we'll set it down. By no means wait at this time for December 21st, or past that, or even for October, November, December. No way wait for those things. No way. I wait for them, that's a failure. I don't want to clinch on the last day of the season. That was 2010. The Giants clinched on the last day of the season. It was so nerve-wracking. It was horrible. I went on to win the World Series, but that was, again, nerve-wracking. Oh, terrible. Now, relaxed, calm. Everybody gets to rest. No strain, no stress. I feel great, you know. So, don't wait until the last day of the season to clinch. For what? You'll be a nervous wreck at that point in time. Now, who is going to clinch? I don't know. Could be any of you, could be all of you, could be none of you. But certainly my responsibility is to clinch the deal. Finish the deal, absolutely. It would be a catastrophic shortcoming to wait. Wait, what would I be waiting on? Waiting on belief to catch up. Belief never catches up. We're waiting in vain. Truth can never please belief. It cannot. What is beyond belief will never please belief. Belief will never believe in it. That's okay. We are not the creatures of belief. We are not the product of belief. We did not come from belief. Belief believes we did. So it will believe that we're insane, or that we're wasting time, or that we're just, whatever we have is temporary, all that stuff. It will continuously throw up disbelief in our face, which is exactly, that's what will happen. That's okay. Because in the final analysis, belief is nothing. And we will all go beyond belief. We don't have to please belief. We don't have to make a friend of belief. We never will. That is for sure, we never will. We will never make a friend of belief. So let us give up the efforts to do so. Lighting conditions are changing all the time here. Clouds are moving around. The sun is going in, it's going out. You see how it is in the world. The conditions are ceaselessly changing. Never more so than coming up the next 3 months. Really. You know for sure there's going to be incredible turmoil. So why trust belief? That somehow belief is going to side with you to go beyond belief? It will not side with you. It will never side with you. And so the task is to say, okay, let's go beyond belief. That's the task. And we're running out of time for that, for sure. It's not too late at this point. It is not too late. It is not too late. Belief is waiting for a savior that it can believe in. There is no savior that belief can believe in. Never will. Belief will make a belief about someone and think that belief is somehow what saves, will be a savior, but no. Reality is beyond belief. Our reconciliation with reality, our awakening to the isness, that's beyond belief, always will be, always. So, a savior can never arise in a belief system. It's not possible. However, what you are is not within a belief system. It's not the product of a belief system. It's not arising in a belief system. It's not limited to any belief system. It's totally beyond any belief system. The isness, the presence of I am, presence of isness, is felt there beyond belief. And that's all that's needed. It doesn't have to be felt in belief. It will never be. The belief will always make something else of it. Always. So can there be a savior of the world? Can there be a savior within the belief system? No, not possible. Will never be. but there doesn't have to be. We simply need to be saved from the belief system, from believing that we're circumscribed, we're bound by the belief system. We are not. We can step right beyond it. We can allow that which is certainly beyond the belief system, not touched by it, not affected by it, to shine here, because the belief systems that we have, the belief system only believes in belief, and yet we are the one that is giving rise to this belief system. Just like a dreamer, some figure can appear in the dream and shine in the dream. Okay, that is possible. But none of the dream figures will understand what that's about. They won't get it. It won't save any of the dream figures. However, it can be that other dreamers of the dream will see this shining figure and it will remind them, hey, you know, I'm the one dreaming this dream. I need to wake up. To shine like that, I need to wake up from the dream. You see, that is what saves. It's savior from the dream, not any savior in the dream, saving the dream figures in the dream. No. It's not possible. So the time is here to get after it completely. It's perfect timing. Perfect timing. Late in the game, but you would expect that. Late in the game, you would expect some breakthroughs to take place. You would expect it. It's simply stepping beyond belief and saying, belief, I'm not going to wait for you any longer, because it's a wait in vain. You can never believe in what is. You can never believe in that. You cannot, because you only believe in belief. And belief is temporary, because it only arises from the idea of trying to be prime creator, which is an idea that will be set down, because it can never be experienced. So belief cannot believe in the permanent. Cannot. Its basic premise is nothing is permanent, because it believes that we can change reality. So it believes nothing is permanent. It cannot believe in the permanent. It cannot believe in that which doesn't change. It cannot. Therefore, it cannot believe in reality. So our experiencing of the fragrance of the remembrance of reality cannot be believed in. Cannot. By anyone. Doesn't matter who it is. Smartest person in the world cannot believe in it. So it's not belief that can relate to it. But there's something within us that can relate to it, which means we are beyond belief. Well, reality is beyond belief because we can relate to it. I was able to relate to the great awakened ones that were in this world. I said, you know, I felt like, hey, yeah, I can relate to this. Absolutely. No question about it. And then there's something in me that doesn't believe it, but I say, it doesn't matter. But definitely there's an understanding, and I can feel it, and it's reaching something within me. And even, there's something also that doesn't believe it and thinks, ah, you know, waste of time and all that stuff. It doesn't matter. I know that something within me is being reached. So we don't have to reach belief. It's impossible to reach belief. Truth cannot reach belief. Cannot be believed by belief at all. Belief only believes in belief. And reality has no need of belief whatsoever. In order to go forward beyond belief, there has to be a certain amount of assurance. And I'm feeling that the last, maybe close to the last, either the last or close to the last recognition is that you cannot please belief. It's impossible. You cannot reach belief. You cannot prove anything. Reality cannot prove itself to belief. Belief cannot believe in reality. That which is beyond it. So, it doesn't matter. You know, we keep thinking we got to find a way to please belief. It's not possible. The only way to please belief is to not go beyond belief. But this doesn't help the situation at all. You still remain entirely bound by suffering. So, of course, belief will not believe in any awakening that takes place. Belief will not believe it. It will say, oh, yeah, you've done something really great. I really like this. And then it'll define it in its own way so it can believe in it, which will be a false definition. So that will happen too. And you have to be willing to allow all that to take place, because there's nothing that can be done about it. But something deeper than belief is reached. And then it's each one has to assess this and go towards the point of finally going beyond belief as well. Each one has to do that. There's a time of assessment. And we better be heavily into that assessment at this time, heavily into it. All these videos are just a warm-up. They're just a warm-up. It's a warm-up act, really. The headline act has not yet taken the stage, but it has to take the stage very soon. And it will take the stage very soon. One way or the other. And this is all just a warm-up. You know, nothing wrong with warm-up acts. It's very helpful. We start getting into the right attitude, the right discipline, the right orientation, the right expectation, all of that stuff. So when the headline and act comes on stage, we know how to get flow with it. We're right there, able to flow with it. Belief isn't defeated, it's just set aside. It's like a shadow is not important anymore. Doesn't matter what belief believes in anymore. It's of no consequence to reality whatsoever, none. So we're really in the great days, the really great days. The nerve to clinch early is super important. Don't let it get down to the nitty-gritty, the end of the schedule. Don't let it get down to that point, because who knows what will happen at that point. There could be an October surprise coming up, right? Don't want to wait for that. There could be a surprise any time. Don't want to wait for that. Turmoil could come any moment in this world right now. Major turmoil. Major distraction. And what is the world about all these beliefs conflicting with one another, isn't it? And you'll think you need to side with a certain belief. You'll feel that, a pull towards that. So it's all important right now to get that determination, get that nerve. Stay in your seats. You know, the riot is about to, the show is about to become magnificent. It's about to become glorious. It's about to be grandeur, great grandeur. It's a show that will outshine the show, the melodrama that belief is about to put on. We have to outshine it. We have to steal a march on it. And all important to do that. As you attempt to do this, you will feel some sort of pressure, something that you're doing in your decision, like you're trying to make a decision, and words drop away. You're not using words anymore, really. It's like you're gathering yourself for a decision, for a step, to step beyond belief. Just let that accumulate. Let it accumulate. Just keep breathing. This feeling of not waiting any longer. It'll be more of a felt situation than a cerebral conceptual situation. The cerebral brings you up to that point, but there's some point you got to gather yourself, gather your determination. So let the gathering of your determination continue. You have to do it because if an October surprise breaks out, if all this stuff breaks loose, it's going to fragment your determination. You're going to say, wait, I need to invest a lot in this, invest a lot in that, and here and there and all this. And before you know it, your determination will be fragmented into many directions, and everybody will be trying to grab a hold of your determination. And you'll feel like you'll be fragmented. There's nothing you need to maintain. No story that you need to be wrapped up in order to step beyond belief. You don't need to leave. You can have a blank slate. There's nothing that anyone needs to read, because belief cannot read what it is that you are shining in the first place. But it wants a story to read. You know, it wants, okay, you had trauma then, trauma, all this trauma. It wants to read your history of successes and traumas and all that stuff. You don't need to have any of that there. You can let it all go. Let it all just evaporate from you. Total evaporation. Let the story of your so-called self, your journey, let it all evaporate. Now, belief will say, oh, there's nothing there. Can't see anything there. How can I believe in you if there's nothing there? The answer is belief can never believe in truth. Never. So we don't need to please belief. And those who are responding to what is beyond belief, they don't need to read any story that is there, and they don't want to focus on that. They want to feel to experience the radiant, shining, sparkling, you know, clarity, presence of the isness. So the isness doesn't need any story there. So let the story evaporate. Let it all go. Let it evaporate. Everything that ever happened to you in belief happened to you so belief could believe in that. In belief. Believe in the objective of creating a power that can destroy reality. Everything that's happened to you has only been the manipulation of belief. You don't need any of it. You can let it all evaporate. So then none of it can get in the way, be activated, be referred to. And only the clarity of the I Am presence of isness and unconditional love is there, steady. And belief will say, there's nothing there. No story, nothing to read, nothing here, let's move on. I fine, let it move on. We don't need to please belief. But those who want to go beyond belief, they'll say, hey, there's a whole lot here. It's exactly what we need to see here. So we can also gather ourselves to let this evaporation take place. What do they call it? Samsaras or something. Let all impressions go. Let them all just evaporate. No longer holding them into a particular book story form. This is the story of me. This is the story of what I've gone through, my journey. This is the story of my journey. No longer need to hold those throughout the pages and throw them to the wind, you know. Let them be scattered to the four corners of the universe. You're not a collection of impressions and traumas. You don't need that collection anymore. Give away that collection. You have a museum. The museum of you. The museum of me. This is my museum. Have a garage sale. Let disperse the museum. Really? Because none of that is what I am. None of that is I am. None of that is the I am presence of isness. None of that. None of that can speak to it. None of it can. It's all belief. So let the accoutrement of belief be scattered. Dust in the wind. And that will happen. Aim your determination at that. And then the presence will stand free and clear, unobstructed by fog, the fogs of all these impressions. You don't need to make an impression on reality. You are reality. Let the fragrance, the breeze, the divine breeze, gently carry all those impressions away, far out to sea. Sure, someone will pull in, you know, everyone's pulling in traumas, weaving the story of me there. Everybody is constantly working on that. That's okay, you can't prevent that. Just let them see that it's possible to let it all go. And then what happens when you let it all go? What is being obscured by all that? Let them see that. Let me say, yes, I can. Yes, I can allow that to happen. There's a beautiful breeze right now. Here. Wonderful day. Wow. It's very sunny, warm, but the clouds have come, trapping some of the heat, and now there's a gentle breeze. It's like, let a gentle breeze flow through your entire story. All the accumulated traumas, losses, difficulties, battles, scars, wounds, sicknesses, deaths, births, let all that simply be carried away on this breeze. You're no longer trying to bind all of that. Unbind it, you know. It's like a binder. Let's say you have a loose leaf binder, and in this loose leaf binder, you have page after page after page. Each page is a, you know, day in your many lives, and you got this huge binder. Just click open the rings of that binder, you know, just click. They open up. Okay. And then hold the binder up, and a breeze comes, and whoo, all the pages are being blown out of the binder, and they're going down the street. Just let all those leaves, and finally, they're all those pages are gone, like leaves on the wind. They're off. And your binder is empty. you set aside empty binder. So what we're getting at is attitude right now. The attitude of simply unbinding, willingness to open up the binder. We don't have to get rid of the pages. The breeze will do that on its own. It's our attitude, our willingness to unbind, that automatically will bring in that which will flow through and disperse all that. Totally disperse it away from us. The attitude of unbinding. The attitude of going beyond belief and accepting, not waiting for belief, to believe in what's beyond belief. The attitude of doing it now. Again, not waiting. The realization that belief will never believe in what's beyond belief. The acceptance of that. Therefore, we don't need a book for belief to read, do we? We don't need to hand out some book when we meet someone. We don't need to say, here is the book of me. Here is the book for you to read. We don't have any book. Because only belief will be reading that book. What we are, the I am presence of isness, which is identity, which is what we are, doesn't need to read any book about some journey we've been on. Doesn't need to read a book about itself, a book about a belief, a book about me, a book about you. Doesn't need to read any books. I used to have a massive library. I had so many books, you cannot believe. I gave them all away. Some of them I gave away. Some I sold to resellers, used bookstores. And now I don't have any books. I have one. I guess I have one book, A Course in Miracles. But actually, I gave away my original book, A Course in Miracles, which I used for many, many years. After about 20 years of constant use, I gave it away. I donated it. So over time, I got rid of all those books, and there's some of the best books in the world, really. It was a library of the best books. Dispersed them all. I have no idea where any of those books are at this point. No, and I don't care. I don't care in the slightest bit. I brought box after box after box, many trips over the time to booksellers and libraries. I donated. Oh my gosh. Sometimes I'd bring 10, 15 boxes full of just donate to libraries. And gradually, throughout time, I dispersed all the books. And you know what? I've never even thought for a second where they are, what happened to them. All these, the story that we have, these books, many books that we are carrying with us at all times, have nothing to do with what we are, our identity. Nothing to do with it. It's merely a cover story. It really is all the different ways that we have covered up for the real agenda of existence, which is to develop this power of destruction over reality. It's just all the different ways we've pretended that we're working on something else. Why do we need those books? Is isness interested in those books? It needs to study the books. It needs to study it to know what it is. Who needs to study the books? Only belief is interested in those books. Because in those books is a lot of cleverness, a lot of deception. Also in those books is a lot of trauma, and belief wants to study those too, and to see how effective the trauma has been. We're not interested in studying any more books. If someone wants to study them, fine, that's their choice. But we don't have to study them. We don't have to be in possession of any books on what we are. What we are doesn't need any books to know what it is. Isness doesn't need a book to know what it is. Doesn't need to read a book. Doesn't need to go through some experiences to know what it is. Doesn't need to study trauma to know what it is. Doesn't need to study birth and death to know what it is. So everything we've gone through in existence is completely unnecessary to isness. to the fragrance of remembrance is totally unnecessary. Doesn't pay the slightest attention to any of it. So exactly who will we be holding on to all this stuff for? Only for belief, because that's all that we're dealing with here. We're dealing with a denial of reality, a belief that we can change reality, which is a belief, and then reality. And this belief is nothing. But it's this belief that's interested in our story. But what can it do for belief? Can it help belief? No, it cannot help. It doesn't matter how much belief studies anyone's story or the story of existence, it will not help belief accomplish the impossible. It's a waste of time. So belief, we may think we're doing belief a favor to hold on to all this books of our days of our lives. We're not. There's nothing there. Won't help belief. Therefore, let it go. Let it go. Let it go. And belief will come to us and say, "Ah, there's nothing there. Nothing there at all. This is a nobody. There's no one here. No help. No help here." That's okay, because belief cannot be helped. Belief cannot be helped. How can we help accomplish the impossible? How can we help belief accomplish the impossible? We cannot. Doesn't matter what belief studies. Belief could study our story endlessly. Would it make no difference? No difference. Still be in a position of absolutely zero effectiveness. So, let it go. Let belief say there's nothing there. But let those who are not looking for a story, let them, you know, see there is no story there, and yet there is the presence there. Wonderful presence is there. It doesn't need a story. That's not story-based. That's not time-based. That's not process-based. What are we losing? We're just losing loss, the story of loss. The only thing we're letting go would be the story of loss. Who needs to study the story of loss? Does that which can never lose need to study the story of loss? It really is that cut and dried, you know. And it's funny because the answer is obvious. When the answer is completely obvious, we can't help but chuckle, you know. Does that which can never suffer loss need to study the story of loss? For what purpose? For what purpose? Remember, this book we have is really not the pages of our life at all. It's the pages of waiting for the impossible to happen. Every day in our book, our story of our lives, each page is simply sum total. I can summarize the entirety of anyone's book can be summarized as simply waiting for the impossible to happen. Simply waiting for it. No matter what else is happening, there's still this waiting in expectation that something's going to happen. It never happens. So really, the pages are blank. As far as meaning goes, you have a big binder full of blank pages. Each page has a little arrow on it that says, "See next page." Then you go to the next page, see next page. You go to the next page, see next page. You've been going through these pages. Every day you put a new page in, you look at it, you read it, and it says, "See the next page." That's all that can do. There isn't any page. There isn't any next page that's going to have the answer to it. You won't find an answer written down on a page. All you're going to find is an arrow saying, "See next page." And of course, we think, well, we spent today getting ready for the next page, which we expect is going to be a real, real great page. And get to it, and You know, same thing. Different font, you know. All we get is a page that says, see next page, but every page is in a different font. We say, wow, that's an interesting font on that page. That's about it. That's about the satisfaction. We get a different font. Every day we get a different font. And we say, wow, it's amazing how many different fonts there are. Yeah, but what is it saying? The saying, see next page. So, I mean, do we really need to be impressed by different fonts? I used to go through all the fonts. I had font collection. And I just keep scrolling through, and I change the text, you know. Hundreds and hundreds of times. I had a font collection. I don't know how many. Thousands of fonts. Thousands of them. It's ridiculous. Of course, I could never find the one I really wanted. Never could find the right font. And finally, I just said, forget it. Just put it in Helvetica, you know, or something like that. Because it says the same old thing. See next page. All we're doing in the world is everybody's like comparing their pages, you know, in their book, in their binder, and comparing the font, saying, yeah, look at the font that you know. And we say, how was your weekend? Well, the fonts were really cool. You know, I had this kind of unusual font on Saturday. And Sunday was a really kind of cartoonish font. That was kind of a cool font, too. Yeah. What did it say? Well, it said, see next page. So here we are today. And we're, yeah. What's the font of the day? But deep down, we're waiting for something to be written on the page that is going to be, You know, winner. Winner. There's never going to be a winner on the page. How can a page be a winner? Or it can say, winner, you're going to be a winner, winner, winner. You're going to be, see next page. And say, you have won. To collect your winnings, see the next page. You go to the next page. It says, congratulations, you're almost there. All you need to do is click on this, and to fill out this, and then see next page and to receive your prize. You see the next page, and then it says, you got to jump through more hoops. It's like a 419 Nigerian scam thing, you know, the scam letters, email scam. just do this, you'll get all the prize. We just need you to do this. Are those direct marketing things. Congratulations, you've won $200 million. But, you know, and it's ready for you to pick up right now. You just got to do this and this and this. That's what we get. Every day, you know, we get a gold embossed page with all these certificates all over the place and signatures of official prize distributors verifying it's all accurate and notary stamps and everything, you know. And you say, okay. And they say, okay. Go to the next page, and there's your prize. And they say, well, there are actually several other winners, and we need to go to the next page to find out who's won. And then you go to the next page, and it goes on and on like that every day. Every day like that. You're a sweepstakes winner, but just see the next page. How long can you remain impressed with just different fonts? You know, different embossed certificates declaring you a winner. It's just you never can locate the, you know, the prize. Why? Because the prize is beyond belief. Belief can't find it. Belief is always searching, saying, it's leading the search. Belief is the search leader. It says, we are going to organize this massive search and we are going to find what you lost. We're going to find it. And so it's engaged in this tremendous search. It's just belief, searching within belief to find what is beyond belief. Belief never had it. How could belief lose it? Lose what it never had? It's not been lost. It's been denied. Belief will always deny truth. That's different than losing it. Okay? No, truth has not been lost. It's being denied, actively denied. It's being said that, it's going to be replaced. It's a story of it's going to be replaced. That's not a loss. It hasn't been lost. It's still right here. It's still right here. It's still where it's always been. And yet we're searching for it. We think we have to find it. How can we find it in belief? We're taking all these notes in our notebook. We've searched here, we searched there, we searched there. Trying to do a more exhaustive search. So let the notebook be dispersed to wherever we searched. Okay, we also have this notebook, wherever this diary of all our searches. We've searched here, and there, and there, and there. It's a record of all our searches, and we want to hold on to that. It's very important because we don't want to double back and do the same search twice. So we consult our book in the morning and say, okay, this is where we need to search today. And based on where we searched before, all these quadrants, let's make this search in this particular place today. Okay. We don't need that search book, the log of all our searches, do we? No, we don't. Doesn't matter where we search in belief, it can never be found. There's nothing there in belief to find. We didn't lose anything. Nothing's been lost. Isness can't be lost to itself. Reality cannot be lost to itself. So what could it possibly be lost to? Can it be lost to nothing? Zero? No. It cannot be lost. It's simply we chose to believe that it's going to be replaced. That's different than lost. It means it's still here, it just hasn't yet been replaced. We're assuming it's going to be replaced. All this search for the self, the isness, is again another cover story. It's saying to God, God, we're not trying to develop a way to destroy reality. We're trying to find the self. We're searching for the isness. That's what we're doing. How can I bring this down? Okay, there you go. That's a cover story again. No, belief was organizing all the spiritual effort to find the self, to find enlightenment, to find realization. There's no such thing in belief. Nothing, reality has not in need of enlightenment or realization or finding itself. All of this stuff is a cover story. It's a way of trying to hide what we're really up to. So as we're busy going about our search for, you know, belief is terrified about losing its search. It says you can't lose your search. You can't give up your search. It's all important. The search is all important. What's it important for? It's a disguise. It's a way to try and cover up what we're really trying to accomplish in existence. What we're really searching for is the power to destroy reality. That's what we're really searching for. But we say, no, we're searching for the self. Which is a strange thing because the self is ever present. Cannot be lost. How could what is everywhere be lost? What is omnipresent? How can that be lost? It's not. It's a misdefinition. We are searching for a way to destroy reality, to destroy isness, the I Am Presence. We want the power over that. So, of course, we're going to say, well, I don't know where it is. It's lost. I'm trying to look for it. If we're aware of it, we would know it cannot be destroyed. There's no such thing as a power that can do anything about it. So we're pretending that it's lost. We don't know where it is, and we're searching for it. That's a pretense. It's a cover-up. It's a disguise. It's a misdirection of what's really going on here. So belief doesn't want us to give up that search. And it claims that it's the one leading the search. And belief says, you haven't found it yet. If you give it up, you'll fail. You can't give it up until you find what you're looking for. No, you only will be aware of what you are when you give up the search for what you are. Give up this fake pretense that is lost to you. Somehow it's lost to itself. That you're presuming the isness is lost to itself, and we need to somehow remind it of what it is. Not true. Not true. None of that is true. call off the search, but more important than that, let the notebooks of your search be dispersed. And belief thinks those notebooks are super important. That's just a pretense too. It doesn't no importance to him whatsoever. Only so that you can keep believing. Like belief will say, look at all these places we've searched. Look what a great search I've been leading. I've had you search in all these places. That shows you what a great search leader I am. And if you lose that book, you might think I haven't helped you search anywhere. And you won't believe in belief. And you'll have to start out all over again, building up trust and faith and belief. Not true. You don't need to search for what is already present. You need simply to drop the pretense that it someday is not going to be present. The presumption. The desire to replace it. If there's a desire to replace reality, then we will not be able to experience reality because reality is self-evident that it cannot be replaced. So we have to believe that somehow it's been lost. We define it as it's lost instead of we're overlooking it or insisting that it doesn't matter that it's here now because in the future it will be replaced. So we don't need a logbook of all our searches to believe in belief. We don't need to believe in belief. Isness does not need any belief in what it is. It knows what it is. It is what it is. And it shares that unconditionally. It can't help but share it. It is shared with all. No limits to the sharing. There's no conditions whatsoever. So as soon as we are willing to accept this, and as soon as we're not going to freak out about it, then it will come. And we'll be, as soon as we're willing to disperse that logbook, you know, if we experience this fragrance of remembrance, and we still got this logbook of our searches, then we're going to say, okay, now let me write down where we found it, and then let me look back at all the searches I made, and let me write a book about how my search led me to find it. You know, it'll be put into the wrong context. It'll be put into the story of the search and how the search finally paid off, finally found what was lost. That's totally wrong context. We cannot approach it from that direction. But belief, of course, all belief wants to look at is, okay, you know, what was the process of leading up to finding it? That's all it's interested in, as if there was some process leading up to it. And if you don't have a logbook of your searches, a belief will say, well, you can't help anybody. You're not helpful. You can't possibly be helpful. That's what belief will say. You can't possibly be helpful at all. And we have to realize that is simply not true. You can't be helpful to belief. That is true. But belief is not all there is it? It's a fact that it's a denial of all there is. It's a belief that all there is will be replaced by something else, which is not true. So all there is still present. It's still present. And all there is recognizes all there is. Isness recognizes isness. Isness knows isness. This type of talk will help isness, that aspect of isness which is still dreaming, still asleep, still enthralled by belief, to wake up from the dream. So it does help. But the belief will always be like a shadow saying, ah, you can't help anyone. This is not helpful. This will never be helpful. And any help that seems to arise will only be temporary, and it's only going to end up in a dead end. It'll say all that stuff. It will never believe, no matter how much help comes, if everyone's waking up from the dream, the belief will still disbelieve all of it and say, ah, never happened. I don't believe it. I don't believe it ever happened. And yet it's still happening. Don't take belief as an accurate barometer of what's happening. It's the most inaccurate barometer possible. Can't possibly give you the right pressure. Can't possibly give you the right temperature. it's a lying weather station. You know, it's a weather station that constantly gives false broadcasts. When the sun is shining, it will say, I don't believe the sun is shining, it's raining. And we say, well, stick your head out the window and see the sun is shining, and belief will say, I don't believe it. It's a mirage, it's a deceit. It will say all that stuff. And basically, it's just ignore it, completely ignore it. Because its spiel will be continuing on like a lunatic. It's like somebody on the side of the road that is a complete lunatic, and it's just gibberish, just complete gibberish. You know, how long does it take before you just tune that out? You're not waiting for them to say something profound. Belief can never say anything profound, and it can never believe in anything profound. It can never believe in what's beyond belief. So it can never talk about it in any way that's meaningful or helpful at all. So it's just like just empty gibberish. And how long do we need to, you know, pay attention to that now? It's just like some fan in the background or something, white noise, just, you know. The great teachers are the ones who completely ignore that. And we see it's within our capacity to completely ignore it. Absolutely. Unfortunately, there are many in the world who want to go beyond belief. But the way that belief bluffs, you know, the intimidation that belief brings, makes them hesitant. But they're there, and they can receive a boost. Belief does not have the type of control that it presumes it has. We're enslaving ourselves to belief. Belief is not enslaving us. We're willingly enslaving ourselves to belief. But again, the willingness comes from us. If we withdraw that willingness, belief cannot hold on to us. When we unbind all our storybooks and disperse them, of course, belief will say that it doesn't know where to put us, you know, how to vet us properly, what kind of job to give us, what kind of role. And belief will say, I don't have any role for you at all. There's nothing to go on. It's okay. Isness has a role for us, which is to shine, which is to abide in the perfume or the fragrance of remembrance. That's the role that isness has for us. So we won't be without a role. Just because belief says it cannot figure out any role for us doesn't mean we'll be without a role. We will have the role of witnessing to the fragrance of remembrance. The I am presence of isness, unconditional love, that will be our role. That we can go beyond belief. There is a role beyond belief. We have a role beyond belief. We have a life beyond belief. We have a home beyond belief. We have everything. Everything that is ours is beyond belief. It's all there for us. So it's not like we will just have nothing to do, no role, useless. That's what belief tells us that. And say, well, if you let go of all this story of me, you're going to be useless. You'll be useless to belief, yeah. But you won't be useless to all those who want to awaken from belief, go beyond belief, you'll be very useful in that regard. And that's the only usefulness that's really relevant in this dream, is the usefulness to awaken from the dream. So we have to set our sails and catch the breeze that is coming now. Just put your sails up. There's all these boats, you know, bobbing in the bay. And there's some that have no sails up. How are they going to get anywhere? Put your sail up. Set your sails and be prepared to, you know, move towards remembrance. Move towards that fragrance of remembrance. Catch that fragrance and move towards dispersing all of the notebooks on all of the various diversions and side trips and time wasting and traumas and deaths and sicknesses and searches and disguises and misdirections, deceptions, losses. Those notebooks are useless. Leave them there on the dock. Don't put them on your boat. On the dock, you have this big pile of library sitting there on the dock, and you're in your boat, tied up to the dock. Just slip the rope off of your, what is it, capstan, or what do they call it? And so the boat is still bobbing by the dock, but it's not tethered to the dock. Put your sails up, and then when you feel a little breeze, the boat will gently start to glide across the water like that. You can still see the dock and all your books. Your library is there. The library of your history is all there. It's all there. But you're moving away from the dock, and you say, you know what? No problem to leave that behind. Because, you know, what you are is in the boat. And the breeze of remembrance is filling your sails. That's all you need. You don't need anything on the dock. You couldn't fit it on the boat anyway. You can still see it. It's in the distance now. More and more it's in the distance, gradually going gently away from it. And you say, well, ridiculous. Good thing I left all that behind. That has nothing to do with what I am. It was all a scam. I was trying to run a scam on reality. And reality's not interested in what I tried to do. Reality's only interested in what I am. And what I am is right here, right now. It's not in those books. It's not in those logs. It's not in my history. It's not in any future plans of becoming. What I am is right here now. So let us work on loosening that rope that's tying the boat to the dock, casting that rope back onto the dock, and getting our sails up. Get the sails up. All these videos are getting your sails up. That's it. Loosen the rope, getting the sails up, setting the sails, and getting ready for the breeze. Now, if you're still tied to the dock and the breeze comes, you know, what good is that going to do? The boat is just going to be rocking like that. And it's going to feel, whoa, very unstable. And then what will you do? You will pull your sails down, take the sails down real fast. Say, wow, that's very unstable. Of course, because you're still tied to the dock, and the boat keeps wanting to go move, and the rope keeps getting taut, and bam, you get jerked back like that, and then you move again, and bam, you know, you just keep going through this oscillation that is, like, very jarring. You don't want that. So the willingness to take the rope off of the boat is all important. So let us focus on that. And the boat is not going to take off like a powerboat. Don't worry about that. It's not going to take off immediately. It might very gently start to move just a little bit. Not fast at first, not fast. It's not like a slingshot that we release it and suddenly we're going to be catapulted, you know, thrown up at, you know, 1,000 miles an hour into the air or across the water. No, not at all. We'll just very gently start to ease out and start to glide across the water very gently and slowly. We're in no hurry. We're free. We're already free. As soon as we untie from that dock and start to move, we're free. We're free of all of that story, all of that, all the notebooks, all the logs, the search logs, all the notes about what we did, what we want to do, what we expect to do, what we hope to do, what we believe we need to do. All of that, we're free of all of that. We just need to sit in the boat and enjoy the ride. That's it. Sit in the boat and enjoy the ride. All right. The sun is shining in right now here. So, let's bring this one to a close if I can see how to do that. All right. Very great. It's all about attitude right now. Let's keep getting, feeling that attitude that we need. Okay, that's it for this one.